We have been keeping Australian native social stingless bees for about 6 years now. They are a fascinating and useful creature. They are great as pets, pollinators, for home gardens and commercial crops, and for honey, of course. Beekeeping is applied insect science, and the more you know, the better the outcome. The deeper your understanding of the role of the working bee in the natural world, the more enjoyable it becomes to watch them. I would recommend you getting your hands on Tim Hurd's book on bees, which has basically been our main source of understanding. I'll leave the link to his book in the description below. The ancestral bee appeared about 120 million years ago when bees evolved from wasps. One species of wasps started feeding its young plant pollen instead of other insects, so bees are basically vegetarian wasps. The timing was ideal as flowering plants were also emerging. So the beginnings of nature's ideal relationship developed. The bees pollinated the flowers and the flowers fed the bees. Since then, many species have evolved and occupy most of our planet. Most bees are solitary, but a few species have evolved very social behaviour. Stingless bees can be distinguished from other Australian native bees by their pollen baskets, their tiny size, and fewer veins in their wings. There are 11 species of Australian stingless bees. Tetragonula and Ostroplebia are the genus, and then each has a number of different species under that. The main difference between the two is the nest structure. Australia has only a handful of bee species that have been introduced. The European honeybee is much larger, and the feral colonies that have developed in Australia tend to, in some circumstances, compete with the native insects and birds for pollen and honey, nest sites, and reduce native plants and increase weeds. The other bees that have been introduced are the Asian honeybee and the bumblebee. Also the leafcutter bee and a couple of others. You can see the yellow pollen sacs underneath the bee's body. Honeybees and stingless bees display the most advanced social behaviour of all bees. This is the first Australian native beehive that we got about 6 years ago now. These guys are Tetragonula hockingsi bees, a very popular species in Australia, but only in Queensland. They enjoy the warmer tropical areas and are hardly ever found south of the border. The hockingsi workers are a little larger than the carbonaria ones. They're a bit more aggressive and tend to defend their hives a lot more. Even though they have no sting, the way they defend is they grab hold of you with their mandibles. They can form larger colonies and with more food stored and a larger quantity of brood. Apparently they like collecting sweat from human skin. The stingless bees operate on a caste system. The two female castes are the reproductive queen and the non-reproductive worker. The queen caste look after reproduction and look very different to the worker caste. The caste system can't be changed, so if you're born a worker, you'll always be a worker. The queens have much larger egg cells, and males constitute a third caste, the drones. One thing I noticed straight away when we got our first hive was the guard bees at the entrance. Every bee in the colony has a job to do. It's assigned its task based on its age. Adult bees start off as house bees, eventually graduating into being foragers when they're older. Their first job is to build the brood or the cells for the eggs. Then they feed the young, handle the food, and make the beeswax. After that, then they are allowed to move further away from the core of the nest, going to the entrance and becoming a guard bee or circulating the air in the hive by flapping their wings. Only toward the ends of their lives do they get to leave the hive to become foragers to collect nectar, pollen, water, and propolis. They even have jobs like taking out the rubbish. Raising their brood creates a waste product, which is made up of the cocoons left by the larvae. The stingless bees also go to the toilet in their hive, so the waste products are bundled up and transported out of the nest in the form of a pellet. So some of these worker bees specialise as garbage removalists. Sometimes you'll see them bringing out orange to brown garbage pellets in their mandibles to deposit outside the nest. Sometimes they just take them over the edge, but sometimes they fly away with them to dump it further away. When the weather is bad and they can't leave their hive at all, the garbage pellets accumulate inside the nest. And so when the weather gets better, they start dumping a whole lot of them out at the same time. The three castes differ in many aspects, including their abundance in the colony, the roles they perform, and their lifespan. The colony will only tolerate one mated queen. She is the reigning queen, and the younger virgin queens are also called princesses. There can be between 5,000 to 10,000 worker bees as part of a colony. When we first got our bees, we tended to have a lot of fighting swarms. The Tetragonula genus often attack or invade hives, and then you have the defending hive creating these huge swarms in the sky next to the entrance. Sometimes these swarms would go on for 2 or 3 days. All the fighters are female workers. Some of the male bees might be there, but they're only flying. We had these swarms come and go over weeks and months. They can occur at any time of the year, but they're more likely to happen in summertime. So the attacking colony are trying to install their queen into the hive. Sometimes these fighting swarms can be triggered by moving two hives into different positions while they're still foraging. The male or drone egg cells usually are wider and stand taller, but there's only hundreds rather than the thousands of the drones as part of the colony. Since the reigning queen is the only one who lays eggs in the hive, then all these bees are brothers and sisters. They're all the offspring of the one reigning queen. The worker bees inside the hive just work day and night. The male's only job is to mate with the virgin queen of another colony, so there is intense competition for this. There is only one queen per colony who lives for only a year and mates only once. The worker bees usually only live for about 100 days. It's harder to work out how long the males live for because they usually leave or are evicted from the nest before dying. The queen is actually selected by workers from a pool of available princesses. The female worker bees actually have a part of their hind leg designed to have a pollen basket built in. Because the males are not expected to collect any pollen, their back legs are designed differently. They don't have any built-in pollen baskets. The males also have larger eyes, weaker mandibles, and longer antennae. Sometimes males from unrelated colonies can form male congregations. Sometimes they can roost outside at night, like some of these bees here on a plant near our hive. They could be waiting for the queen to come out to mate. And as soon as a male mates with the queen, he dies. The queen will then go back to the nest and lay all the eggs. She will not mate again, but she can fertilize all the female eggs that she will lay for the rest of her life. To create a female, she will fertilize the egg, and if she wants to create a male, she won't fertilize the egg. So all the bees in the colony have the same mother and father and are full siblings. This is a stark contrast to the European honeybee, whose queen will mate with multiple males and all the bees in the colony will be half siblings. The queen is much larger than all the other bees in the colony, and she is surrounded by a court of attending workers, like maids. And the princesses in the colony are also kept hidden in case they get killed. It's all starting to sound a bit like Game of Thrones, isn't it? One in a thousand brood cells are queen. The only difference between a female worker egg cell and the queen is that the queen gets fed more, and this turns her into a princess. Oh, if only that was true for humans. That is why the queen larvae becomes 2 to 3 times bigger in size than the other egg cells. Sometimes the bees will seal up their hive to end the battle, but other times the warrior bees will just keep on going, fighting. The swarming bees grip each other with their mandibles and fall to the ground, connected together. They will never release, but will die in mortal combat. We have seen hundreds and hundreds of bees just littered all over the ground. Let's take a closer look inside the hive. When we first opened up our hive and saw the structures inside, we thought it looked like some alien from Stranger Things. But they are actually very well organized. You can see the connective tissues that hold the nest together into the walls of the hive. The larger pots are for the honey and the smaller are the egg cells, and the smaller the brood, the younger it is. The brood is just another name for the egg cells, and the egg cells or brood is kept separately from the honey pots or the food storage. This is a carbonaria nest, and you can see that it's quite different to the tetragonular one. So the colony means the whole unit of bees operating together to bring up their young. The nest refers to the actual physical structure and the building materials and the food stored inside. And the hive actually refers to the colony of bees, their food storage and the building materials. Paul makes all our hives out of hardwood and we sell them now as well. After we got a couple of hive boxes, we also got some hives that were still in the log. So in nature, the bees will typically nest in any cavities, including empty tree trunks. Stingless bees usually use propolis, which is a mix of beeswax and plant resins, as their building material. Propolis is actually the ancient Greek word used to describe before the city, so it seems quite apt. The blue tape on the log was used to cover up the entrance hole, so you can see the entrance hole in here, and you can see just a few little bees just sticking their heads in and out of the entrance, and you can see a little bit down the entrance tube as well. As soon as the blue tape was removed, the bees go straight to work. You can see these bees emptying their rubbish and collecting propolis. This one looks like it's bringing home some pollen. This is what the nest looks like inside the log, the hollow log, when the top piece of wood was taken off. This was a different log hive that we got. You can see the nest structure from the outside of the log. The queen is responsible for laying all the eggs required by the colony, and she doesn't do any other work. She even doesn't have the baskets on her legs that are needed to collect pollen. These are our beehives now. We probably have over about 20 hives or more. And every year, if the hives are healthy, we'll split them and sell them. There's actually a fly here trying to gain access to the entrance of the hive. You can see that it looks a little bit different to the bees, and the size of the fly is actually quite a lot bigger as well. It's a guard bee that chases this fly away. If you watch very closely here, you'll see a bee with pollen going out of the hive and then going back in. These are the little pollen baskets attached to the bee's legs. The stingless bees have many natural enemies that try to attack them. Obviously, you have the spiders. Spiders build their webs around the hives to trap them. The best you can do is just try to keep the area around the front of their hive free of spider webs. This little girl obviously didn't make it. Ants, geckos, and toads can also be an issue.